Hi, everyone. Thank you so much for allowing me to talk today. It's a pleasure to get to speak to you. So I'm going to be talking about load balancers at DigitalOcean, basically how we utilize HAProxy not only in our internal services, but also externally and through our product offerings as well. So if you're not familiar with DigitalOcean, we're a New York-based cloud hosting provider that was founded in 2011. We had a rather modest beginning, essentially being a VPS provider. We primarily offered droplets, which are our compute instances. But our primary focus is the user experience and community. I hope that some of you might have run across our tutorials in the past, ensuring that the developer experience is as simple as possible and just enabling individual developers to succeed is our passion and kind of fundamental to everything that we do. So currently, we operate in 12 data centers across the globe, and we're managing in excess of about 1 million active droplets over tens of thousands of hypervisors today. We've grown a little bit from our beginning as just a single offering of droplet. We now have S3 compatible object storage offering called Spaces, DBaaS service, managed Kubernetes platform called DKS, and as was mentioned before, a little bit more expanded networking capabilities with Cloud Firewall and nascent VPC support. We use HAProxy extensively internally, both for internal services and in our product offerings, and I'm going to talk a bit about each of those today. So I'll start with the regional network service. The regional network service is essentially the engine of software-defined networking at DigitalOcean. Its primary responsibility is orchestrating the overlay network that ensures tenant isolation on our private network. Now, an overlay simply is the process of encapsulating traffic at a source and then writing it over a very simple IP fabric to be decapsulated on the other side. And to be presented to the VM. And every single state change that happens inside of a user's network, it becomes a one-to-many action. So if a user creates a droplet, needs to live migrate from one hypervisor to another, or to destroy, that needs to be propagated out everywhere. And the regional network service's primary purpose is to orchestrate this full mesh of tunnels between members of, we call it a virtual chassis, of which there's only one today, but soon there will be many available. So this is the general shape of the architecture itself. We're fronted by two load balancers that front a service called NorthD. And NorthD is the primary integration point for our software-defined network. So when our compute services essentially want to add a member of this chassis, remove a member of the chassis, create or destroy a chassis, it's inbound to this service, which is then persisted in a local MySQL cluster. From then, an asynchronous process kicks in, an internal API called convergence, which has the responsibility of making it so, as it were. So it generates essentially these apply virtual chassis messages that are then placed on a message queue, in our case, RabbitMQ. And there are southbound workers, which we call SouthD. And they're responsible for invoking RPCs against a daemon local to the hypervisor called HVFlowD. And on each hypervisor, we utilize OpenVSwitch to express our data path, our pipeline. And from there, we translate that that message into OpenFlow and then persist it in the data path. And then from there, we're able to encapsulate and decapsulate accordingly. There are also some ancillary services that are responsible for projecting the state of the chassis towards our user-facing services. So for instance, we don't necessarily have to round trip to Bangalore to be able to say, OK, what's the state of this chassis? Now, the load balancer tier, essentially, this is consistent with any bare metal clusters at DigitalOcean. We have a process called ExaBGP, which is responsible for peering with the upstream top-of-rack switch that announces the cluster's VIP and is essentially actively health-checking through HAProxy. HAProxy itself is balancing between the NorthD instances with a relatively straightforward configuration, least connection, TCP. It's running 1.8 at the time. time, if HAProxy does wedge or is unavailable for any reason, host route is withdrawn, and we fail over to the secondary load balancer or back and forth. And this general pattern is consistent to many services that are just internally deployed on bare metal. Spaces, for instance, follows a very similar pattern. I'll focus a bit on the edge of our network. The edge gateway is essentially our internal API gateway. And it simplifies essentially publicly exposing any internal services in our cloud control panel, which is the user interface that is that you use to control your access to droplets or like creating and destroying, and the public API itself. So it gives us a really clear path to break apart some of the monoliths internally, and gives us a really great path to like distribute our architecture and really shift into like a fully microservice operational pattern. And it has simplified the integration for being able to develop however you wish, but we've standardized on Go internally in DigitalOcean. It also generalizes concerns such as feature flipping external features, doing internal rate limiting, and also authorization concerns, passing down user IDs. This is what the general architecture looks like for an incoming request into our control plane. DigitalOcean.com itself, the DNS is served from Cloudflare. We utilize their services for DDoS mitigation, so on, for our control plane. And we then come inbound to NYC2, which was our second data center that we built in New York. And from there, that HAProxy cluster balances to edge gateways, which reside in our New York City data centers, which also come back to all of the microservices that are responsible for orchestrating droplet and floating IP, et cetera. So the public load balancers, it isn't a crazy scale. It's servicing about 600 requests per second, so that's all control plane traffic. It's also responsible for routing requests towards edge gateway or along with the other static sites that we manage. So all of our tutorials, our community sites, dub, Hacktoberfest, are served through these. The one thing that we have noticed with edge gateway specifically, as we increase the number of processes there, if we aren't cognizant of how health checks are implemented, it can provide a little bit of burden on downstream services, and it's something that we've had to be careful of in the past. LBAS is our product offering for load balancer as a service. We initially offered this in early 2017 as a way to find product market fit. So when floating IP was released, we noticed that users were essentially rolling their own highly available software, and we wanted to be able to wrap that in such a way that it was simple to be able to do that on their own without having to burden the user with that. So the initial offering of load balancer is essentially DigitalOcean primitives, so namely droplet and floating IP. Backend droplets specified either by name or by tag. We also have an integration with Let's Encrypt that really simplifies certificate manage, allowing it to be fully managed, auto-renewed, roll automatically. Simplicity is essentially the name of the game here. And it's built on HAProxy itself. The image is HAProxy 1.8, and the product surfaces all of the configuration that you would expect, essentially algorithms between round robin or least connection, sticky sessions, proxy protocol, and it allows to terminate at the load balancer itself or just pass through to the backends directly. So as I was saying, this is the current offering, and when a user creates a load balancer through our public API, it then reinvokes the public API to create a primary instance and a backup instance, which are running an HA agent and has a floating IP pointed into the primary agent once that configuration is pushed to the instance. From there, we have a regional health checker, which is pulling the floating IP consistently. If it notices that the primary instance is unavailable, we'll then just failover to the backup and destroy the primary instance and then stage another backup droplet to serve as the new backup in this case. Now, this served 80% of the use case and gave us a sense of the appetite for this in the market, but it does have its challenges because while it's simple, it does really give us a limited means to be able to scale the current offering. Vertically scaling can only really go so far, especially how we queue into a VM itself. And having to traverse two network stacks also is suboptimal. The idle compute instance as well, having just a backup droplet sitting there idle, isn't the best utilization of our infrastructure. And so we want to find a way to be able to effectively eliminate that. And for each droplet that is created, we do allocate a public V4 address, which, as we all know, is scarce and expensive and is something that we want to rein back. The product is seeing an increased usage just due to integration with further upstream service products on our platform. And so the next evolution of Load Balancer, I won't belabor this architecture because we've gone into what a software Load Balancer looks like in numerous sessions, but essentially is going to look like very typical. So having equal cost multipathing into multiple layer 4 load balancers to be able to evenly spread across HAProxy instances into our backend. It, of course, gives us the redundancy necessary, allows us to be able to horizontally scale, and gives us the performance that we desire to be able to satisfy customers, users, and some of these upstream products that are demanding a higher scale of usage. How we plan on implementing this is via Kubernetes itself. So instead of KubeProxy, we're going to drop in KubeRouter, which will be responsible for peering with the upstream routers and handling the advertisement of the VIP itself. IPVS will function as our layer 4 balancer, running maglev to ensure consistent hashing across the load balancer pods in the cluster itself. And the pods are just going to be running a similar image that we have in the existing product, HAProxy on the back end. Now, one of the complicating factors here is the integration into our existing software-defined network. So in addition, we're going to need to leverage Open vSwitch on Kubernetes as well and to be able to land a daemon that we're going to call ConfLowD that will be able to watch the placement of these pods and to be able to ingest these apply virtual messages from our orchestration software. And from there, we'll be able to ensure connectivity into our backend droplets and be able to orchestrate as we expect it to. So that is a very quick tour of some of the usage of HAProxy internal to DigitalOcean and what I wanted to speak to today. We have a bit of time, so I'm happy to answer questions.
Okay, thank you so much, Neal.
Thank you.